So welcome to the Future Car Podcast. And when it comes to autonomous cars, one of the things that everybody always worries about is, will an autonomous car be safe? And there's no driver in it, so it's a little bit of worry can sometimes pop up. And today we have someone that's really been on all sides of safety. It's Mark Rosekind. That was on the National NTSB, the National Transportation Safety Board. So he's been on the government side. Now he's on the commercial side. So he is just the person to give us a true perspective of safety from A to Z for autonomous cars. Mark, welcome to the Future Car Podcast.
Ed, a pleasure to be here. Looking forward to talking to you.
Well, let's start off and maybe just tell us a little bit what's Zoox all about. There's a lot of autonomous car companies out there. They don't all have the exact same approach to autonomy. Tell us a little bit about the Zoox story.
Well, Zoox, from the very beginning of its creation in 2014, has taken a fairly unique approach in wanting to basically integrate the ecosystem of mobility. And when you think about it, this moment of transformation that's in front of us, we can really enhance safety, mobility, and sustainability in our society. And Zoox wanted to do all three of those. And the company really believes that we need an integrated system to pull that off. And so the unique part was we were doing the full stack, build a vehicle from the ground up specifically for autonomy, do the AI and all the computer pieces to make that operate, and three, actually provide the service as well. And that integrated system, we think, is going to be the best way to deliver this service into the real world. And we've seen that work in things like the iPhone. And that is nothing compared to the complexity of transportation where lives are on the line.
If you are just going to make autonomous vehicles to sell, let's say, in some ways, that's a lot easier than what you just described, because not only do you have to create a vehicle, but now you have to worry about charging, maintenance, infrastructure, buildings in the places where you're going to store the vehicles, whatever it can be. So a lot of moving pieces to doing the whole mobility as a service with autonomous cars.
Yes, and thanks for raising that, because just to add a little more depth, Zoox is all electric. It's designed for sharing and specifically in congested urban settings. You know, so that's where we're hoping to, again, increase the safety, move people around where you don't have to own a car. You could share one of the Zoox vehicles. And one of the really cool, unique things about Zoox is its vehicles are also bidirectional. There's no front or back. And so when you think about, again, a dynamic, complex and congested inner city, we won't ever have to make U-turns or three-point turns, et cetera. It's built for operating in that congested urban setting. And to your point, yeah, it's harder because you're not just sort of putting something into an existing vehicle. You're talking about building from the ground up to answer and deal with this problem of all the congestion, the safety, and the problems of moving people in big cities.
So when you build a company to do this, you have to look for a wide variety of people then. In other words, it's not just engineers that are going to engineer the car or software, but you have to have people that know how to maintain and maintain a fleet of vehicles.
Yes. And again, your previous question kind of went to that, which is it's not just about the engineering the vehicle. And in fact, I like to point out, I think the big challenges right now are the actual deployment. You know, rubber meets the road in cities. How are you going to do that? So as you were just asking previously, it's like, what about the grid? We're all electric. How do you make sure that the city's prepared for that? You need more of the engineers just to figure out about the movement within the city and when there are pop-up construction zones and all the dynamic aspects of the other road users that are there that you have to interact with. Much more complex and dynamic in a congested urban setting than when you've got in, you know, sprawled out country settings, for example. So yeah, a lot harder. I always bring up more complex, more dynamic makes it harder, but it's also where we've got bigger problems to solve.
Your platform for mobility, right? Designing it from the ground up, which opens up a lot of things for you to do. And I think one of the things I saw that you talk about is a journey to enjoy, you know, maybe like a living room on wheels or whatever you might want to call it. How do you create a journey to enjoy? It sounds really, really good.
Well, let's start with we get to design the vehicle from the ground up for you, the rider. The cars on the road today are mostly designed for a driver in the left front seat. We got to put a steering wheel. We got to put all the operating controls, right? In fact, there are even different crash criteria for the front versus the rear seat. So what happens with a clean slate? We get to say the rider is the priority. What do we create for them? So it begins with the fact that we're carriage seating, right? It's not rows like this. It's like carriage seating. It's like, talk about going old school, right? I mean, it's a carriage for you, the
Right,
consumer,
right, right,
right?
right.
Yeah. And so it's
And
built,
carriage seating means it's
two people
carriage
looking
seating
at the other
is
two.
face to face.
Yeah, two people look at the other two people, right? And so it's a very social environment. It's a nice open environment. You're not worried about your knees. I've been in our vehicle, that's been built and crash testing already, et cetera, with I'm 6'4", and I've been in with other folks about my height, and knees don't touch. There's a lot of room, so it's very spacious and open. And yet each individual seat also has controls over their music and air conditioning, and the other things that, make it comfortable. And we're designing for sharing. So you could go in on your own and be the only person in there, but you could also be in there with your family or your friends, right? Or, three other strangers. And so it can be very social, or you could just be there kind of working on your own stuff, bringing your pad in there and doing whatever it is you want.
Let's move on to safety because I know that's a topic you really want to cover. And I think one of the interesting things that you've mentioned is this whole idea of proactive safety. And I've heard you say that the aerospace industry has been proactive, but the automotive industry has been more reactive. So what exactly is that? Maybe you can give some examples from the aerospace industry and what's the difference between proactive and reactive safety?
So let's just start with auto and reactive for most of 100 years. And that is, crashes are going to happen after the fact. How do we figure out, to make things safer? And so that unfortunately means we're just acknowledging crashes are going to happen and how do we help more people survive them? Okay. Proactive is when we're thinking, how do we do safety efforts ahead of time that prevent those collisions, injuries, fatalities from happening in the first place? And so I like to point out our sort of protect or prevent and protect basically says the ultimate safety is preventing that crash from happening in the first place. And so new technology that allows you to have automatic emergency braking so you don't crash into things, your planning so that you actually don't get close to where there's something that's going to be a risk for you, right? That it automatically adjusts your speed for whatever the weather is, et cetera. So those are the kind of proactive things that you can do that help you deal with situations that prevent those crashes or injuries or fatalities from happening in the first place. And aviation's just done a great job. I mean, they had a couple decades ago some horrible crashes with too many people losing their lives. And they said, what are we going to do to try and make this better? And so whether it was in training or procedures or technology, they did whatever they can. And I point out, commercial aviation went 12 years in the United States with no single fatality. 12 years with zero fatalities. It's like we're in crisis on the road. If we could get to that level of safety, it would be superb, right? Right now, 95% of all fatalities in transportation happen on our roadways. How do we use those lessons learned, apply them to the roads, and start saving those lives?
Do you think that the aerospace industry focuses more on safety, or they just focus on it in a different way that the automotive industry hasn't learned yet or just hasn't applied?
That's a great question because I'll tell you the answer, which is that in aviation, they do not compete on safety. It's not a competitive issue. It's like we're going to get together and deliver safety. In the auto industry, they sell safety, right? And even
Yeah,
NHTSA, I mean,
certainly
I used to,
Volvo.
and all the other cars, look at this system and this one's going to be, right? And again, I ran NHTSA, which does the new car assessment program, NCAP. Right? Those are stars for cars that you see on the right there on the window of the vehicle. So you're literally, is it a five star or four star? You would never get on an airplane and say, gee, where are the stars next to the cockpit so I can see if it's a five-star cockpit?
They're all
Of
five
course,
star.
you don't compete. You want everyone to be five-star, right? And so I think that's one of the basic things is we got to get, and it's not that the auto industry doesn't collaborate on things, but I think sometimes the going in is, always trying to up. And so, as administrator, when I was at NHTSA, one of the things we talked a lot about is how do you democratize safety? There really should be one level for everybody. And so whether that's making pricey safety options, automatic emergency braking, available for everyone, or one of the latest issues you see is, guess what? Crash dummies should actually represent our population and our society, right? Not just 95% male or 50% male. We really should have one level of safety for everyone. Whatever gender you are and wherever you're sitting in the vehicle, we need to get there. And I think there's clearly room in the auto industry to emulate some of the things that have happened in aviation.
How do you get an industry, like you said, they're competing. They love their five stars of safety, and the other guy only got four or three. How do you get them to say, we're all going to work together? And is that the role of government somehow to provide incentives, or how do you do that?
Well, again, what a great question because so having been in a lot of different environments, board member at NTSB, an administrator at NHTSA, and a scientist at NASA, I've had a chance to see the safety system from a lot of different angles. And what your question brings out is there is no one group responsible for safety in the auto industry. It's all these groups playing their role. And what you just identified is, in fact, one of the critical roles for government, for NHTSA, for the Department of Transportation, to be able to step in and say, look, these are the big objectives. Here are some specific things we expect everyone to do. Sometimes that's regulation, sometimes that's another policy, sometimes it's something else. And then how do we reinforce and incentivize people to do those things well? Because that brings safety to everybody. And so if you don't have every sort of player, every stakeholder, fully engaged, then you're going to have gaps. And so, to your point, some of those changes have to come from government. But you know what? Industry does that too. They do best practices. They don't wait for the government to say, regulate us. We're going to do this. And I bring this example up all the time. As administrator, we challenge the industry to make automatic emergency braking standard on all vehicles across their fleets by 2022. I mean, this was in 2015, okay? It would have beat regulation by 4 or 5 years if they could do that. And 20 of them signed up, accounting for 99% of all the new cars manufactured, and they're pretty much there. I mean, we're in 2022. So that's the democratized safety. Government didn't have to regulate, but it gave the challenge, and the industry stepped up, and that will, now, guess what? You could do it faster. You could do it better if you want. But at least everyone is going to get that democratized safety. Everyone's going to get that level of automatic emergency braking that pretty much equals the playing field for everyone.
We could probably talk about this for the entire hour. And we're definitely going to get into the technology part, your third one. But just real quick, safe system approach. What does that mean, safe system approach?
It's so interesting because people say it's the hot new thing. It's not new. This came from Sweden and some wonderful work they've done that looks at the system. Human choices and errors contribute, and people are screaming about the statistic, but 94% of the last cause in a crash is something the human chose or an error they made. And the safe system basically acknowledges, well, errors happen. So what can we do designing the roadway system or speeds that help us control those kind of choices and errors? So they don't end up in somebody losing their life. So that's the more system approach that gets to road design. I mean, the classic example are roundabouts that control speed, for example, cameras that sort of maintain that. And in Sweden, they, using the safe system approach, they've cut their fatalities down by 50%. So, I mean, we know it works, and it's now being more emphasized in the DoD proposal and for the last 5+ years or so, maybe 10 in the United States.
There's a lot of different aspects to safety, and there's safety inside the vehicle, there's safety of the people that are around the vehicle. Thinking a little bit about around the vehicle, communication between, and let's just look conventionally or traditionally, right, non-autonomous, there's a lot of communication, eye contact, or whatever there might be between the driver and the pedestrians. Here in Boston, there's this rule, right? If you're about to enter a roundabout, don't look at anyone in the roundabout, because that means if you make eye contact, they have the right of way. If you don't look at them, then they'll stop for you. So, and there's different rules of the road on how you do that. So what is Zoox doing when it comes to trying to communicate with the people that are going to be around one of your vehicles?
So this is a really, really important question, because you and I are used to that social contact, right? The interaction with the eyes connect, your body's looking at it, or literally you're waving, right? I mean, it's like you've got communication methods that we employ. So at Zoox, we're using light and sound. And so we have a couple of really cool things that our folks are working on to use sounds, you know, that let you know not just that we're there, but what our intent is, as well as lights and the combination of those two being able to communicate our intent. Because that's the big, the two things are, one, I see you, right? So I see you, and two, here's our intent. I see you and I'm holding. I see you and I'm slowing down. I see you and so we're using light and sound to communicate those things. And, you know, your question earlier gets the point. There's so many individual differences. You got to figure out what are those communication signals going to be that actually mean the same thing to as many diverse people as you can.
So I'm about to step onto the street and your Zoox, you call it a Zoox? What do you call it? Does it have a name?
It does, but we're not really talking about that yet. But we do call it a vehicle because it's not really a car. So the Zoox vehicle.
Right, a vehicle. Yeah. We'll call it the vehicle. So the Zoox vehicle is approaching. What exactly is it? How is it going to communicate to me, one, that it sees me, and two is, hey, don't worry, I'm putting my brakes on, go ahead and cross. How exactly does it do that?
So one of the things that we have talked, one of the things we've talked about publicly is we actually have a speaker array that is beamforming. So it literally can send a signal, you're going to step off the right side curb. I can send you a signal and the people, you know, crossing and doing something on the left won't even hear it or hear, like won't even recognize it. So remember what we talked about. The first thing is to get your attention so you know I see you. And then the second is to communicate whatever the intent is. And so that audio signal could go right to you to say, I'm here, I see you're there. And then the next signal, which could be an audio signal, will let you know what we're doing. And so we're testing those signals to figure out which are the ones that communicate to you, we're stopping versus you have a red, you need to stop. Right? We're still not going to go if you were to cross, but to try and get your attention to get your head up from the phone, notice it's a red, you're supposed to stand there, right? So again, that first thing is the signal that gets your attention to make sure we've got that contact so we can send you the next signal. But just so you know, to be clear, what those signals are to make sure that absolutely the intent, those are still being developed. Nobody's got a set of those that are automatic or well-known. People are still trying to figure that stuff out.
Yes, that common language we were talking about before.
Exactly.
Will it be a signal or will it be like a speaker that's, projecting a spoken word like, I see you, or is it like some sort of a beep sequence or what do you think?
Yes. So that's what I'm saying. So one of the things is I'm telling you a bit about the beam forming because, when you hit the horn, that gets everybody's attention, right? It's not focused in any way. So the beam forming allows us to direct the message. But you've got it, which is, should that be a word? Should that be a series of beeps? Should that be an ongoing? That's the communication language that's being developed. And as you've said, wouldn't it be great if it becomes a common language rather than every company's got their own version of it?
Another form of communication is, should there be some sort of an accident and there's a first responder coming in or a team coming in? With autonomous vehicles, you're losing a level of an ability to communicate, right? Because it's not the person's car that they own. Are you doing anything special to help with that?
So this is personal for me because I come from a law enforcement family. And so Zoox in particular has a very high priority on first responders. And, you know, the first thing that comes up always from first responders is, how do I even know what your vehicle's doing? Is it stopped? Is it going to move? And then we get to sort of the joke scenarios of like, who do I give the citation to? There's nobody in the vehicle, right? There's no driver. License and registration, please. Where do I find those, right? You know, just, and then of course, the more serious things that if something happens and they have to actually get in for a medical emergency or something else, how do they do that? And so we've had a lot of interaction with the first responder community, which is usually law enforcement, fire, and EMT. And I always point out, it doesn't matter what city you go to, they are a core of the city. You know, the politicians come and go and other things change, but those are core. And so that's another place where a lot of companies, and again, for us, it's a priority. It's personal for me. But, you know, we're having a lot of interactions with folks to figure out what kind of educational material do we have to create? What kinds of guides do you need? A lot of people focus on the electric part. You know, what part of the battery do you have to stay away from? Cut here, cut there. But as we were just talking, there's all these other issues, right? About if I'm going to pull this vehicle over, how do I know it even sees me or it's going to do what I need to do? And if it pulls over, who do I talk to when there's nobody in the vehicle, right?
Now, who do you talk to?
That's right. So
what do you train them?
Well, we have in the Zoox case, we have microphones and speakers. And so because we have a teleguidance system, a human in another center somewhere monitoring the vehicles in our system, we would know if that vehicle is pulling over and could literally talk directly to an officer or firefighter or somebody who is approaching the vehicle. And by the way, it also could make it easier rather than look for insurance or other kinds of things in the vehicle. We literally could say, what do you want? I'll email that to you. I'll text you whatever you need. And then you even have it in digital form, right? So we're talking about evolution in a bunch of those areas that could be good for everybody as well.
You know, one of the things we started talking about at the very start here was this, it's designing and building the vehicles and then running the services and all the infrastructure you need to deploy everything. I would imagine, and certainly in just talking to you in the last few minutes here, I started saying, wow, maybe I am feeling a little bit more comfortable, you know, now that I know that there's someone behind, behind a human that's behind it all. So imagine now you're starting your service. It's you want people to be happy and you want people to make themselves actually use your service. I would imagine you need some sort of a campaign. I don't know if it's an ad campaign or somehow to inform, hey, it's going to be okay. Is that part of it all? I mean, and how do you go about even doing that?
So when people ask about trust, I always say it takes three things. Data, like to our question, how safe is safe enough? We got to show you it's safe. Two, we got to be transparent about that. So to what you're asking now, we have to have, you know, a transparency, a campaign that lets people see what we've done to make it safe and trustworthy, et cetera. But the third thing that's really critical is experience. And that's what the problem is right now, is these are not on every corner, right? You can't go outside your house, pull out the app and get a ride. When that starts happening, people will get a ride in these and realize, oh, that was easy. That worked. I mean, I got to tell you, we do test rides in San Francisco, not in our built from the ground up vehicle, but in Toyota Highlanders that have our AI system on it. And, you know, when you get out and you ask, you know, the demo riders, so how was that? And they say, well, that was boring. You know, it's like, perfect.
Actually,
that's what you want, right? It shouldn't be too exciting. It should just be, you know, I can read my book or do my thing. You're like, after a little while, the novelty wears off. That's what you want. You're only going to get that when you get experience. So when all these other companies are doing demo projects and providing rides, as long as they are safe and giving experience with these things, that's a good thing for everybody.
I'd like to take a step back and talk a little bit about your background and your inspiration. You said your father, I think your father was a motorcycle policeman and was in traffic enforcement. I believe that was a big inspiration for you early on.
I don't talk about this a lot. Actually, was it my Senate confirmation hearing for being NHTSA administrator that actually kind of talked about this publicly. But my father was a motorcycle policeman in San Francisco, and he was chasing a traffic violator when somebody ran a red and hit him. So he was killed in line of duty. I was 3 and a half. My brother was 2. And so we were one of those headlines, right? Officer killed in the line of duty, leaves widow with 2 young kids. And so it's one of the reasons I know 38,680 lives lost in 2020. For some, that's just a number or a statistic. For me, every one of those numbers is a father or mother, sister, brother, a community member, one of your colleagues. Those are people. And we can't bring them back. You know, we can talk about all this stuff for safety, but we cannot bring those lives back to us. And so, yeah, this is personal for me. I often talk about, I don't lead with that, but when people want to talk about these issues about safety and, you know, choices we make, this is personal, very, very personal for me. And so whether it's the law enforcement side or, you know, people lose significant members of their family and friends, you know, it affects you your entire life. So yeah, this is personal for me.
Well, along those lines then, so you're an alertness expert of some kind, certainly the greatest alertness expert we've ever had on Future Car Podcast. So here I want some advice for our listeners. So certainly you want to be proactive, but let's say you're in a reactive mode, you're driving and you catch yourself starting to do that head nod, a little bit dozing off. Is it better to roll the window down and have cold air on your face, or maybe slap your face a little bit, maybe, or turn the radio louder? What do you, or pull over is probably the best thing to do. What do you recommend there to get yourself alert again? Is there any
Okay.
tricks maybe that you could teach us?
So, Ed, we are about to save some lives. You ready?
I'm
Great
ready.
question. We're going to save some lives with this. And you're right, this is my area of expertise. I'm the Lifetime Achievement Winner from the National Sleep Foundation. I have over 150 publications. Like, this is stuff I do, keeping those pilots and astronauts awake, right? So, what do you do as a driver? First of all, when you get the head nod, pull over. By then, your brain, one of the studies I did, one right back here, was giving pilots naps in the cockpit. Why did we do that? Because they were falling asleep 2 or 3 at a time, including when landing a 747. Okay? So if your brain is sleepy enough, it will fall asleep even in a life-threatening situation. So if you're in your car and you're getting a head nod, it's too late. You got to pull over. And don't just pull over, you want to pull over, and if you can, take a short nap because only the sleepiness is going to help reverse that. So, to your question, brilliant, because that's what people say. Can I roll the window down? Can I slap myself? Can I turn the radio up? Can I turn the lights on? Those things work for 10 minutes. So, they'll work just long enough to get you to a safe place to pull over. But if you do those thinking you're going to make the next hour, half hour, even 15 minutes of your ride, that could be when the crash occurs that could take your life.
You're somewhat in a unique position because of your experience in government and now in one of the leading companies that's creating autonomous vehicles and a service based on autonomous vehicles. How do you compare the perspective of government regulators versus people on the commercial side of things when it comes to safety? How do they look at it differently? How do they look at it the same?
So I think to your point, the ones who keep safety like literally in the bullseye as the primary target look at it the same. It's about saving lives, preventing injuries, preventing crashes, etc. But to your point, it's what path do you take to get there? And so government investigators or regulators are going to look at the levers or tools they have available to make changes that will save those lives and prevent crashes. Whereas in a company, it can't control the whole system. It's got to be thinking, what product do we create that's going to help us save lives or prevent those injuries? So they may have the same central objective, but they will come at it from different kinds of angles. You know, that's why I often people say, like right now with autonomous vehicles, that, the regulators are always going to be behind because the technology is changing so quickly. And I
Yeah.
always, yeah, well, and I always point out the government doesn't actually build stuff. That's up to car manufacturers, plane manufacturers, iPhone manufacturers. It's, technology and other companies that build things. The regulators are always going to be late, if you will, because they come after when the new technology has been innovated. And then the job is to make sure the government regulators can come, hopefully early enough, to make sure the guardrails are around so that new technology is safe. And I always say this, which is even now, with all the talk about AVs, great potential. We still have to prove it. We still have to prove that it's going to give us the benefits that we talk about.
From the commercial side, having been on the government side, if you could give some advice to the people in government right now on something, let's just call it the top thing that they could do sooner rather than later to improve the environment, to get commercial, well, to improve the environment, to get autonomous vehicles out there and operating, what would you recommend to the federal government to do?
So, can I do two
You can do
quickly?
as
Yeah.
I'll let you go for as many as you want. I'm sure they could use a lot of advice.
Well, I think actually one of the first things the government can do, which is a wonderful role they can play, is to bring the different parties together. So the industry can get together and say, we want to do these safety things. But sometimes, as we discuss, there are competitive concerns about intellectual property or whatever. They don't always talk to each other. If the government says, I'm getting you all in the room because I have the safety objective, I want to know how we're going to get there, they can be a great motivator to bring those people not just in the room, but to problem solve. So that's the first thing. I think, NHTSA and DOT can be a great forum to bring groups together. And that's why the second thing, just to give an example of that, is there's a huge problem, right? I've been bringing this up a few places, but there's a huge problem right now with all the different language that people use to describe all this new technology. ADAS, right? Supportive systems, full ADS, right? Automated driving systems. Like, what do all these mean? AEB versus ACC, and I'm using these acronyms for a reason, which is people don't necessarily know what they mean, and what does it mean actually in my vehicle? So again, a great example of what government can do is get people together and say, okay, let's nail the language down. And going forward, this is what we're going to call X and Y and Z. So when we were talking about communication earlier, same issue is how do we make sure consumers, other road users, have a consistent language to understand about this new technology? That's just one example.
Sometimes with autonomous vehicles, we don't think about the more traditional aspects of that vehicle. And you actually touched on them, at least mentioned them a few minutes ago. Four-wheel steering and shorter stopping distance. I mean, those are things that you could put in a traditional car. So what's the four-wheel steering? Maybe you could explain that a little bit for our listeners, but it makes the car more agile, the ability to steer more quickly or into tighter spots, whatever it might be. But maybe tell us a little bit about that. And also, what exactly are you doing to make the stopping distance shorter? So, two
So
things
I
there.
hope people, well, and I was going to say the short one, I hope people go to the report because it gives really nice diagrams of all that stuff. And I think the example I would give is you're driving in a city where there are cars parked on the right and you see a bunch of kids over there playing and now you're worried about that ball coming into the street, right? So that's the model. The four-wheel steering gives you the accuracy to know, you know what? We can just move 6 inches, a foot further left into a lane that gives us more time to react if that ball should come. The braking system, same kind of thing, is that being able to stop in a shorter distance means if that comes, not just a quick one, but seeing it with our perception systems, there are actually kids over in that area, gives us a chance to slow down. So we're actually braking from a slower speed than having to brake at, say, a higher speed. And so that's why, again, you can read the specifics of the technology that's in there. But it's thinking of the scenario where you would use both the steering and the braking, to make a difference in what kind of safety you could be providing for that kid that might dart out, that all of us fear could dart out in front of our vehicle.
I want to ask you, it's the year 2050, right? We've had all this great communication between all the suppliers of vehicles and services and all that kind of thing. What's it going to be like? Listen, I'll pick Boston here. I'm going to step out out of a building and I'm going to look around at the sidewalk. I'm going to look around at what's on the road. What do I see?
Hopefully, you're going to see a whole new mobility system that gives you even more access to whatever you need. So if you want to take public transit, there's some system like a Zoox vehicle that could literally pick you up at your door and take you to a bus station somewhere, okay, or a rail system somewhere. Or you can come out the door and you can get your app and basically, you know what? I need to get out of the state and go skiing in Vermont, okay? And you can pick someone else who can do that for you, all right? Or you're going to your door because there's a delivery that was supposed to show up and it's not somebody on a bike or in a car. It's literally a robot that's showing up at your door for you to be able to take what you need and put in your return, okay? So I just so you know, what I'm talking about here is everyone who's crystal balling, I don't think we know. You know, I think
nobody knows.
And it's going to be, and you know, the example I give is the iPhone, right? Over a dozen years ago, if someone said, what would you pay to have a phone in your pocket? Maybe two, one for work, one for personal. And by the way, you'll use it for texting. What's that? Well, that's an app. What's an app, right? I think the same thing's going to happen here, but with our whole mobility system. That things we can't even imagine yet are going to be out there on the street helping you and so many others move around that we haven't even thought of. And the number one thing I hope in 2050, if we're not at zero fatalities, we're getting pretty close.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate your time and answering all those questions. But, you know, if I ever see you off the air, I'll probably ask you about what that dream is. So thank you so much.
Thanks, Ed. Really enjoyed it.